this business of the sacrifice of Isaac is a rich vein to mine. What I mean by that is that there's much treasure here. You know what a gold mine is. And there are veins, there are little arteries in the mine where there's a lot of gold. It's a rich vein. And Genesis 22 is a very, very rich vein. The great oversight in preaching in the West, the thing that we're leaving out, the thing that we're not talking about in our churches, is the cross. The cross. People want to know how they can get things for themselves. How can Christianity help me get what I want? People are not interested in giving things up. The cross means giving things up. And the cross really doesn't mean, well, now I've got to give up drugs, or now I've got to give up immorality, or now I've got to give up selfishness, or now I've got to give up lying. That's not really the cross. I mean, those things may be a part of the cross, but that's really morality. Any moral person would hope to give up those things, whether they were a Christian or not. What is the distinctive of the cross? The distinctive of the cross is not when you give up a bad thing for God's glory. It's when you give up a good thing, or maybe even all good things, for God's glory. And the proof of that is in the cross of Jesus himself. What bad thing did Jesus give up on the cross? What bad thing did he die to? Nothing. Because everything in his life was good. He gave up life. His life was perfect. His life was a life of healing, of mercy, of restoration, of resurrection, of truth, of teaching, of encouragement, of binding up broken hearts. He gave up the right to be the king of Israel, to sit on the throne of his father David. How good would that have been? How good would it have been for the Jews? How good would it have been for the world? This is a good thing that Abraham is asked to give up. This is the cross. This is the cross in the Old Testament. This is a man giving up the gift that God had given him, the gift that God had promised him. Now, there are many levels we can think about this in. I was once preaching in Western Europe. I was preaching at a church retreat. And I was invited by a family that I knew in the church who were very committed believers. But I was told, not only by that family, but by the pastor, that there were a lot of unbelievers in the church. And the subject of the teaching was Abraham, the life of Abraham. And when I taught Genesis 22, one of the men in the church who may or may not have been a believer, one of the men in the church became angry. And he said, "Why would God do something like that? Why would God do that to him? Why would God do something so terrible? Why do something bad that good could come?" That's what he said. And he asked me that in front of everybody in the building. And here's what I told him. I said, "Well, first, I want to say that Abraham did it to himself." And I said, "I can't prove this, but I do know that we always reap what we sow. And what do you think Abraham would have been tempted to think when God told him to sacrifice his son, before his son had any children, to take away the possibility of the promise being fulfilled. Because not only does Abraham have to have a son, but his son has to have sons, and they have to have sons, and they have to have sons. And if Isaac dies before he has any children, then the promise can't be fulfilled. Now, we know that Abraham did not give in to temptation, that he did not give in to doubt, because we know from Hebrews 11 that Abraham was confident that even if he actually killed Isaac, that God could raise him from the dead. So again, there, Abraham by this time had a faith which extended beyond the biological life of Isaac because he believed in resurrection. That's why it's so important that your faith and my faith has to extend beyond our biological lives, because we believe in resurrection. We don't believe God lets us down, because God has a whole eternity to bless us. And we want that blessing of eternity. You may think that you're more interested in the blessings of this life. You may not be interested in blessing after you die. But let me tell you something. When the day of your death draws near, you'll be interested in it. And on the day you die, you'll be very interested in it. And after you die, that'll be the only thing you'll be interested in. But how did Abraham do it to himself? Well, what do you think Sarah thought when Abraham dropped her in Pharaoh's tent in Genesis 12? And Abraham dropped her in Abimelech's tent in Genesis 20. What do you think she thought? What do you think she'd been tempted to think? You think maybe she thought that she had been betrayed by her covenant partner? That she had trusted him and he betrayed her? You think that Abraham may have been tempted? I don't think he ever gave in to this. Hebrews 11 said he didn't give in to it. But you think that the devil may have tried to tempt Abraham to think that his covenant partner had betrayed him? That now God had given him a son, but now he's going to have to kill his son? That God had betrayed him in that way, and that Isaac was going to die before he was able to have children? Wouldn't that be betrayal by the covenant partner? You know what? I can't prove this because the Bible doesn't say it. But I think that one thing that was happening, not the only thing that was happening, not even the most important thing that was happening, but I think that one thing was happening was that Abraham was reaping what he'd sown with Sarah. And I can't prove this. But I believe when we get to heaven, it wouldn't surprise me at all that we will discover the exact number of minutes that Abraham thought he was going to have to kill his son was equal to the exact number of minutes that Sarah thought, I'm never going to see him again. In any minute, a man whom I don't know is going to come in this room and rape me. But you know, there are a lot of other things going on. It says that God tested Abraham. God wanted to know how big Abraham's faith was. Now, I said this is a dangerous thing to study. Here's the reason it's a dangerous thing to study. This doesn't mean that it would have been right for Abraham to kill Isaac. That's not what it means. This means that God would never require anything of us that was not right. And if we, by the command of God, have to begin on a path that does not seem right, if we're sure that it's God's command, we will discover before we get to the end of the path that it was a right thing. God never, never wanted Abraham to kill his son. God did want to test Abraham's faith, but God wanted something else. God wanted Abraham to know what it was like to be God. Because God did sacrifice His Son, His only Son, the Son whom He loved. You got to understand something. God loves His Son better than we love anybody. And there's something else you got to understand. Whoever you love the most, God loves them more. Now, remember when I told you that when God made the world, when He made the universe, He made a matrix of realities which corresponded to the heavenly realities and the heavenly relationships? We talked about fathers and sons, mothers and fathers and children. We talked about marriage, husbands and wives, and how those were pictures and patterns of a heavenly reality. God made us in His image. God made us in His image to the point where we could have a relationship with Him, which would be meaningful, where there would be correspondences where He could speak to us and we would understand. He has to get us to that point by making us in His image, where He could love us and we could love Him back and it would be a meaningful thing. And even though that's true, there's a point where the place where God seems most like us is the place where He is least like us. Remember what we said earlier today. It is true to say that we are made in God's image. It is not true to say that God is like us. Now, I've been making all these decisions about what's the highest place in the Old Testament and what the most important chapters are. And of course, I have no right to do that. But since I started, let me keep it up. I don't know what the most important verse is in the New Testament. But I can tell you the verse that covers the ground that needs to be covered if we're going to understand the heart of the gospel. And that verse is Romans 8:32. And Romans 8:32 is connected with Genesis 22. Now remember what we've been saying. The place where He seems most like us. Well, how is He like us? Well, we get into the world because of a father. We have fathers and mothers. We have children. He's our father. We're His children. We have all these things which are so connected and so similar so that by analogy we can understand Him and what He's doing and what He's teaching us. But here's what Romans 8:32 says. He who did not spare His own Son. He who did not spare His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all, will He not also with Him freely give us all things? Now, don't we feel that we're like God because God has the heart of a father and we have children, so we know what it's like to have the heart of a father or the heart of a mother. Yes, He is a father. Yes, He does have a son, but He's a father who did not spare His own Son. Now, what does a father do? A father bends all his energy, all his efforts, all his longing, in every fiber of his being to spare his children, to see that his children do not come to harm, to see that his children live. He who did not spare His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all, will He not also with Him freely give us all things? You see, God wanted Abraham to understand what it was like to be God. what it was like not to spare a son. He was never, ever going to let Abraham kill his son.
Even a small contribution can make a big difference. Jesus fed 5,000 people because of a little boy's 5 loaves. Regardless of the amount, your contribution is very important and greatly appreciated. Visit us at tvsseminary.com.
I would love for us to be in Munich together sometime. And if we were ever together in Munich, I would take you to the Alte Pinakothek, the old picture gallery, which was about a 15-minute walk from the place where our church in Munich used to meet. That church does not meet there anymore. And in the old picture gallery, there is a room with 12 Rembrandts, all depicting biblical themes. It's probably the most dramatic room I've ever been in. 10 of the paintings represent, there are 10 total paintings. 8 of the paintings represent New Testament themes, including the magnificent raising of the cross. You know, we know more about what Rembrandt looked like than any other man who lived in the 17th century. You know why? Because he loved self-portraits. I think we have over 50 self-portraits of Rembrandt. He loved drawing pictures of himself. And so we know what he looks like more than we know what anybody else looked like who lived in that century. And he had flaming red hair. And in his painting, The Raising of the Cross, it shows Jesus being hoisted up on the cross. Jesus is hung there, and the men are all around him raising the cross. And in the foreground, in the middle of the picture, one of the men raising Jesus up on the cross has a green painter's cap. And out from under the green painter's cap are the fringes of the flaming red hair and the face of the artist, Rembrandt. What's he saying? He's saying, I did it. It was me. I'm guilty. I killed him. On the other wall are 2 Old Testament paintings, including the sacrifice of Isaac. And Rembrandt paints the picture at the precise moment that the angel comes and sticks his hand out. And you see the moment where there's a startled expression on the old man's face. And he's dropped the knife. The knife is in midair because the angel has stuck out his hand and touched his arm so that he dropped the knife. And the thing that's so powerful in the picture are the startled expression on the old man's face, the dropped knife, and the exposed white flesh of the boy's throat. Because the boy is lying on the altar with his hands tied behind him. And Abraham's left hand is over the boy's face. And the knife is raised and the throat is ready. And at that moment, God intervenes. But I'm getting ahead of myself, okay?